The following is a special presentation of HBO Sports.
Dear Roy Jones, although we've never met, I feel as if I've known you for more than 6 years. Like millions of other sports fans, I tasted the outrage of that fraudulent decision that denied you an Olympic gold medal. I've always wanted for you to have another chance at that kind of glory. So in that sense, I was with you last Friday night. I know there were skeptics who had questioned your professional opponents, and even your ability. This would be your chance to erase their doubts. That's why you took the gamble of giving up your own title to fight James Toney for his. That's why you put your reputation on the line against a more experienced, more proven, more respected, unbeaten fighter. It was as if you had shouted to the gods of boxing, "Please, Lord, give me one chance to prove I am the best." In matching you with James Toney, the boxing gods answered your prayers. You were so fast, oh so fast, so good, you made one of boxing's best champions look like just another sparring partner. You even showed the nerve to showboat and the audacious ability to back it up. On this night, you didn't just win a boxing title, you earned universal respect. We can put the memory of Seoul, South Korea to rest now, because you've finally been validated as the best. For those of us who were fortunate enough to witness your victory, we can forever say that we were there the night Roy Jones Jr. fulfilled his quest and quieted his recurrent nightmare. Sincerely, a boxing fan. MGM Grand in Las Vegas, 13 days AGF after George Foreman. And once again, this is the scene of another momentous boxing battle. The super middleweight title clash between James Toney and Roy Jones Jr. Two unbeaten boxing champions meeting in the prime of their careers in a match toward which the days have been counted by the boxing public for as much as a year. James Toney against Roy Jones Jr. in this ring, and we were there. Hello again, I'm Jim Lampley. If you're a boxing fan, you know by now that James Toney against Roy Jones on Friday evening, November 18, brought the first loss to the record of a man who, going into the ring, had the longest unbeaten streak of any champion in the sport, and brought to fruition the talent of a man who had long been trumpeted as one of the greatest prodigies to have entered boxing in recent decades. Larry Merchant, in the moments before the fight, you told us that most of the questions surrounding Toney Jones went to Roy Jones Jr., by far the lesser known quantity. Did he, with his performance here, answer all those questions?
Yes, and yes again with a lot of exclamation points. The questions about Jones were basically this. Was he a superstar, which his talent, his raw ability, the quickness and the power suggest that he could be, or was he a fraud because he had consistently refused to fight the best and baddest fighters out there, which James Toney always had done as a champion. Coming in here, we didn't know if he had the right stuff and the left hook to put any hurt on an outstanding fighter. He answered yes and yes again to all those questions, and he turned what was supposed to be a fight into a terrific solo performance.
A virtuoso performance, and justifiably most of the attention in the aftermath of the fight goes to Jones. But in the days leading up to the fight, and even afterward, a lot of attention has been paid to James Toney's gargantuan struggle to get down to the 168-pound weight limit. and then the bizarre ballooning process by which he added 17 pounds to his weight in the 28 hours between the weigh-in and the time when he entered the ring. Gil Clancy, given all of your experience as a manager and a trainer working with fighters who had to condition themselves and make weight, do you think that what happened to Tony had anything to do with what happened to him in the ring?
Well, absolutely. I've never heard of a fighter putting on 17 pounds overnight. I mean, I had a fighter, Emil Griffith, that was a welterweight champion. He fought Dick Tiger for the middleweight championship of the world. I brought him in at his most efficient weight, which was only 150 pounds. For this fighter to come in and put on those 17 pounds, it had to blow him up, and he knew he was fighting a fast, fast fighter, and it showed in the ring. He was completely outsped for the entire fight.
How big a factor was it? Answer that question for yourself as we go back now and look at all 12 rounds of James Toney against Roy Jones, the hotly anticipated fight of the year, Friday night, November 18, at the MGM Grand. Tail of the tape. And you can see that James Toney weighed in at 167, Roy Jones at 168. They're similar in age, similar in height, similar in reach, but the big story, James Toney supposedly went to bed last night 8 hours after weighing in at 167 and weighed 183. Tonight, before leaving his dressing room to come into the ring, he stood on a scale, and you can see that if this scale is accurate, James told us the truth. He weighed 184 pounds, 17 pounds over yesterday's weigh-in level as he got ready to come into the ring tonight.
That's an astonishing rise in weight, Gil. I don't know if any young fighter has ever had to do anything like that. Take a look at the punch stat numbers here. Don't know what these mean, except you can see that Tony is a busier, constantly busier, and more efficient fighter. Jabs. Jones uses the jab mainly to set up his hooks. He's not really interested in doing any serious business with the jab, but it's his hooks that will determine the outcome of this fight.
Rules of the bout with our unofficial ringside score, Harold Lederman.
James Toney and Roy Jones Jr. will box tonight using the rules of the International Boxing Federation. 12 rounds. There is no standing eight count, no three knockdown rule. You cannot be saved by the bell in any round, including the last round. Only the referee can stop the fight. And in case a cut is caused by an accidental headbutt, and that cut causes the fight to be stopped, we go to the scorecards after six rounds have been completed. Before that, it's a technical draw. Jim.
Packed house at ringside here at the MGM Grand. And Roy Jones Jr. chooses to enter in a mock tuxedo. You see the designation there, former IBF middleweight champion. He gave up that championship, Larry, for the right to come up 8 pounds and challenge for James Toney's super middleweight title.
Well, for him, this is his entire career. It's a fight he's been aiming for since he got robbed of that decision at the Seoul Olympics. I call his style, Gil, as a kind of a brilliant amateur. He can get away with doing things because of his quickness that very, very few fighters can. Sort of like Muhammad Ali or Hector Camacho, a few others I can name. One thing we knew about Ali was he had the right stuff inside when all was said and done. That's what we have to find out about this man tonight.
Well, that's what we're going to find out, Larry. Roy Jones himself doesn't know what he's going to do in that ring. He's very, very unorthodox, but he has great balance. He's a great athlete, and things just happen for him.
Roy Jones Jr. is unbeaten, 26 fights, 26 wins, 23 knockouts. You see, he's listed as the number two IBF super middleweight contender. He is regarded as having spectacular knockout power with either hand.
Well, you know, they say that the punch that hurts you is the punch that you don't see. He throws his punches from such odd angles that he can nail you and you just don't see the punch.
And now Jones may be forced to play a little bit of a waiting game in the ring. But here comes James Toney.
We've got to talk about that weight. I've never heard of anything like this, particularly for a young athlete. When I was playing football, I knew of guys who had lost 8 pounds in a workout in the severe. They get it all back by the afternoon. But to put on 16 or 17 pounds in such a short period of time, can it do him any good?
I think it can do him a lot more harm than good. I think you're supposed to be your most efficient weight, especially when you're fighting a guy that has a lot of speed. You don't want to give up any kind of speed, and putting that much weight back on could certainly slow him up. He may look like he's fighting with cement shoes on.
You know, Ray Leonard said an interesting thing before. The conventional wisdom has been that Jones had to get Tony hurt in trouble early in the fight because Tony would come on. But now, because of this weight situation, we don't know which way it's going to go.
I know that Jones is always dangerous very, very early. I've seen a few of his fights, and he lands that left hook from way outside, which is an unorthodox thing to do because he does leave himself a little bit open. But the first time he hits the opponent with that left hook, you can see the surprise on their face, like, what the heck is this?
You saw Tony waiting briefly as he refused to enter the ring until the dress system would play his entry music. Now here it comes. IBF super middleweight champion James Tony, since he won the middleweight title from Michael Dunn in 1991, this has been the most active major champion in the sport of boxing, Larry.
Yeah, and that's why he's gotten better and better. The only champion I know of who's been really active during his reign, other champion, is Julio Cesar Chavez. In his prime, when he was great, he kept active, fighting fights in Mexico none of us even ever heard of, and it's paid off for him, and it's paid off for Tony so far.
One more footnote on the long battle to trim down to the 168-pound weight limit and then the massive weight gain in the 30 hours since. According to Nevada State Athletic Commission Dr. Flip Womansky, rapid fluid loss followed by rapid fluid intake would make someone more vulnerable to bruising and cutting. So we'll have to watch and see if that holds true for Tony tonight. James Tony's record in the ring, 44 wins, 2 draws, 29 KOs. We've seen him win from every conceivable circumstance, by come from behind knockout, by come from behind decision, by early knockout, by late knockout, you name it, he's done it. And now let's go up to ring announcer Michael Buffer for the pre-fight introductions.
Ladies and gentlemen, Top Rank Incorporated, along with your undisputed, undefeated King of Beers, Budweiser, proud to be your bud, present World Championship Boxing. This bout is sanctioned by the International Boxing Federation with the approval and sanctioning of the Nevada State Athletic Commission, Chairman Dr. James Nave, Commissioners Nat Carasalli, Luther Mack, Dr. Elias Ghanem, and Crispin Rivera. The Executive Director is Mark Ratner. IBF Supervisor at ringside, Bobby Lee Jr., Chief Medical Officer in attendance, Dr. Flip Womansky. Attending physicians are Dr. James Wishgame and Dr. Robert Voy. The timekeeper at the bell, Al Bicek. Counting for the knockdown seconds, Jane Broadfoot. The scoring for this bout will be done on a 10-point must system, and the three judges assigned are Glenn Hamada, John Stewart, and Jerry Roth. And when the bell rings, the man in charge of the action, working for the 104th time in a world title bout, referee Richard Steele. And now, ladies and gentlemen, from the MGM Grand Garden, here at the MGM Grand Hotel, Casino, and Theme Park of Las Vegas, Nevada, somebody's O must go. Ladies and gentlemen, let's get ready to rumble! Twelve rounds of boxing for the super middleweight championship of the world. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the white trunks with gold trim, and weighing in at 168 pounds, this 1988 Olympic silver medalist has a professional record of 26-0, 23 by knockout victory. Tonight, he steps up from the middleweight division, where he has already captured a world title and puts his perfect record on the line. Ladies and gentlemen, from Pensacola, Florida, introducing the challenger and former middleweight champion of the world, Roy Jones Jr.
Yeah.
his opponent across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, wearing black and weighing in at 167 pounds. He brings his outstanding record into the ring tonight of 44 victories without a loss. He has scored 29 KOs and has two draws. And while compiling that record, he has captured two world titles. Listen, gentlemen, from Ann Arbor, Michigan, presenting the two-time world champion and reigning super middleweight champion of the world, James Lights Out Pony.
All right, I spoke to both fighters in the dressing room. I'm cautioning you again. Obey my commands at all times. Shake hands. Good luck.
Jim, when we get unbeaten champions meet like this, we often get a kind of creative friction that bursts out into the pure flame. That's what we're looking for tonight.
One quick note, Gil and Larry. I was told late this afternoon by a source I trust from Roy Jones Jr.'s camp that he hurt his right hand in sparring a month ago, has not hit the heavy bag with the right hand for more than a month, has not put a power shot at a sparring partner with the right hand for more than a month. So he comes into the ring tonight with the right hand a mystery to him and those around him.
Putting more and more emphasis on the left hook that does the most damage for him.
He's been throwing triple left hooks in sparring to make up for the absence of the right hand. And he throws a right hand there, seemingly with conviction.
And you notice when the James Tony stalks an opponent, or when he jabs, he has a tendency to drop that right hand, which can be very, very dangerous against a good left hooker like Roy Jones Jr. Here's that quick left hook, again, from an unorthodox angle.
Tony has blocked all of those punches.
Jones short with the right hand there. Tony looking confident, if a bit defensive so far. Willing to wait and see what Jones has got here at the outset.
He's keeping his hands up and he's putting pressure on Roy Jones. And again, you can see the quickness of Jones, that side-to-side movement.
Jabbing and hooking with the left hand. Only a couple of right-hand shots so far by Jones. Nothing has landed. Tony has been cautious and measured in his approach. Right hand misses for James.
Hunter, get out. Hunter, get out.
Double left hook by Jones. Right hand was a glancing blow. James Tony told us he would be able to counter because he didn't think that Jones would be able to resist taking the lead in the fight.
Up to this point, Jones has been doing all of the leading.
There's a quick right hand by Jones, and it looked okay there. Here in round one, he's been able to double and triple up with the left hook.
It wasn't good. You catch that hook, that's the shot that we're going to take away from the hook. When you catch the hook, come back with your hook. Catch the hook, come back with your hook. Keep cutting the ring off of him. Make him miss them shots. Especially the right hand. You can twist on the right hand, counter the right hand. But keep that hand.
He ain't getting in already. He's going to sit that hook up. You'll catch him clean sooner or later. Way to work. Deep breath. Okay, we're ready. So you stop pulling, baby. Way to work. Way to work, champ. Keep control.
You heard Bill Miller talking to James Toney. Watch the left hook. Just watch the left hook. And when you catch it or duck it, throw your own left hook. Good advice, Gil?
Absolutely. If he could nail Jones, if Jones misses that left hook, doing an awful lot of damage. And there's Toney trying to get off that big left hook.
It was blocked by Jones. Toney looking like he wants to open a little bit more in this round after an exceedingly cautious first.
Don't hold him, don't hold him. Break. Step back, step back.
Couple of body shots by Jones.
One sounded like it landed on the cup for Jim. And again, Toney carries that right hand across his chest. He's not protecting his chin. He got it up there, though.
And Jones managed to thunder one left hook behind Tony's guard, but most of these punches being blocked on the gloves by James Toney.
But again, if he throws seven and two get through, he's still scoring some points. Toney has to punch back.
Toney hasn't found many openings.
And there was the quickness of Jones again. He made Toney miss and nailed him with two of those unorthodox punches. They come from all angles.
Right hand to the body by Jones. Finally, James Toney gets through with a left hook to the chest of Jones that drove back into the corner. Good right hand lead by Jones.
Again, Jones makes a lot of very tactical errors, but he has such fast reflexes that he can get away with making mistakes.
Oh, don't hold him down.
There's that quickness.
Fast hands. Leaping with the left hook. Opened the glove as he threw the right hand to the body. Jones hurt the right hand against Bernard Hopkins a few fights back.
To get out. Don't hold him.
Sneaking in the right hand after Jones had landed over the top.
Break, step back, step back.
Again, these two fighters, completely different styles. Toney is just trying to walk in, put a little pressure, physical and mental, on Jones. And Jones,
the left hook got behind the guard, Gil. Jones wobbled Toney just slightly with that left hook.
Short notch shots up a little bit. When you can catch him when it comes in. Especially when you're twisting with the right hand, back with the left hook.
Here's the flurry at the end of the round by Roy Jones. None of those was a clean punch, but they are scoring punches. They will count in his favor. His quickness is decisive through the first two rounds.
On his head, let's go. Keep the control just like this. You're doing good. Keep it going. Stop pulling. Let's go.
Let's go, baby. Big disparity in punch output in rounds one and two. Would you tell James Toney to step up the act level, Gil?
He's going to have to do something. He can't walk in without throwing punches.
Low blows by Jones. Steele didn't say anything. Still, the edge in quickness is decisive, as Larry put it.
Quickness and reflex, Jim. I mean, he makes Toney miss, and he's so quick countering.
Get out the road. Get out.
Showboating by Jones. The attempt fake, think. Left hook, and down goes Toney.
You know, his seat never hit the canvas.
But they're going to call it a knockdown anyway.
I agree, Larry. I don't think it was a knockdown.
He wobbled back, but he did not go down.
Reggie Johnson knocked him down in 1991. This, if it is officially scored as a knockdown, is the second time in Tony's career that he's been down. Crowd on its feet. Jones with plenty of time left in the third.
Up to this point, it looks like an added weight that they put on James Toney is an albatross around his neck because he's very, very slow. Or maybe his Jones is just that fast. But he's being completely outsped in this fight so far.
Jones looks fast against everybody, but he certainly looked faster against Toney than some might have suspected. Good counter by Toney. Jones says, come on.
That was Toney's best punch of the fight. He caught Jones coming and nothing happened.
Right hand lead by Jones.
Punching it out.
Unorthodoxy playing in his favor now.
He's fighting with so much confidence, Jim.
Greg, step back, step back.
Well, if he didn't use the right hand in sparring, he's using it here, and so far fairly effectively, although most of the heavy metal has come from the left.
Yes, but he has thrown that right hand to set up the left hook.
Sweeping left hook by Toney.
Come on, punch it out, yeah.
And more quickness inside from Roy Jones. Good defense there by Toney, who was able to duck and slip.
Yeah, but it's okay to say no, 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 but they're still scoring points for Jones.
Take the right hand away from you.
Yes, sir.
All right. It's just a little off the mark, but when you're going in jab, double up on the jab.
Right. I wouldn't drop.
Here's part of the debate going on with hand gestures and fists. We don't see from that angle whether Jones indeed went down. Perhaps we'll have another angle that we can't see it. Here it'll tell us right now. You see, his behind never hit the canvas, Gil.
Absolutely. I did not think it was a knockdown. He did stagger back, but he didn't go down.
Harold Lederman, let's open Harold quickly. Why might that have been scored a knockdown, Harold?
Jim, if the ropes are holding you up, if the ropes wouldn't have been there and you would have hit the canvas, that's a knockdown under the rules.
So in your view, is that a knockdown?
A knockdown for sure.
All right, round four begins. And given the knockdown, you've now got at least the possibility that Toney's 4 points behind on all three scorecards. Not necessarily, but it's possible.
Well, he's digging himself a big hole right now. We've seen him come back in the past from bad cuts, etc., etc., but he can't get too far behind with this will-o'-the-wisp he's in there with.
You heard Bill Miller tell him to keep throwing the right hand, and he was trying it there, but he missed wide.
Well, in my opinion, he should be concentrating on the body.
Another left hook by Jones. That one didn't stun Toney, but it prevented him from throwing anything in return. Toney just not able to counter effectively, Gil, except for one time so far. Solid left hook there. Toney talking to Jones.
Again, what talking doesn't do you a bit of good. And the other guy's piling up points.
Is he ever?
Toney just looks like he can't get off. Whether it's Jones' movement that's bothering him or with the extra weight that's bothering him, something's bothering him because he traps Jones and gets beat to the punch time after time.
Well, there was a good counter right, and he came with another right cross behind it. Jones throwing right hand, then left hook combinations. And a right hand over the top from Tony. And Tony just beginning to get off a little bit here in round four.
No holding. Greg, step back. No holding.
Tony is getting closer to finding the range. Right now, you can just see him getting closer and closer to the mark.
Getting more active.
Break, step back, step back, hold it.
Good left by Jones as he wound the right hand up. He lands three or four more punches. The hand speed display continues spectacularly for Roy Jones.
Just unorthodox punches. Tony doesn't know where he is half the time. Where Jones is in there.
We're getting a little closer to him now. When you hit him with the right hand, come back to the left hook. Woo! Having fun, baby.
Getting a little closer to him. Reaching him was wrong. Hit him with them right hand, come back to the left foot. But jab your way in.
There you go. There you go. You know what you're doing. Way to work. Way to work. He's slowing down something.
Harold Letterman, your scorecard after four rounds.
Four rounds to nothing, 40-35, Roy Jones Jr. He's really given James Toney a beating so far. He certainly gets an extra point for the clean knockdown in round three. Roy Jones all the way.
I've got Roy winning the first four rounds just as well.
And I have as well.
Tony said to Bill Miller, boy, I'm having fun. Only a prize fighter after taking some of these punches could say that.
Give him up, Tony.
They trade shots to open round five.
But again, Jones landed the last two punches of that exchange.
And the first two punches there. James has nothing to throw. Two more left hands.
His unorthodox movement and his unorthodox punches are completely befuddling James Toney up to this point.
Right hand, left hand combination by Jones landed. Toney landed a left in return. Tony starting to snap to it a little bit, but still outgunned in almost every change.
Tony has got a punch to the body. Can't. That's where those punches belong. Stay downstairs for a while, then that head will come to you.
Himself so far down that he's got to go for a late round knockout against Jones. That's going to be tough because of Jones's quickness and defense.
And if Jones is himself comfortably ahead, he can certainly kill the clock.
Big left hook by Jones. Two left hooks.
Tony pretending not to be hurt, but he's wobbled. Now James lands a right hand in return. Tony trying to take advantage of the chance opened up by Jones's aggression.
Jones will not let Tony into this fight. Tony lands a hard punch. He comes back with two.
Break.
Roy tried to end it with a right hand right there. Just missed.
Right hand counter by Tony, but Jones was moving away with the punch. Here's where Tony has to get off when he has him on the ropes. He's got to bank to the body immediately.
He's got to be busier. That left hand landed, but it was a glancing blow.
Talk about unorthodox. He spun around and landed the left. Jones is supposed to be the unorthodox guy.
Solid left hook by Jones. And you saw James Tony's head snap to the side again. Tony's got the lunch pail out. He's starting to go to work. But Jones continues to box circles around him and land the heavier shots as well.
Jones certainly answers some questions about whether he has the right stuff inside him in that round.
Well, he got nailed with a couple of punches, Larry, but again, he would not allow Tony to take the edge right back.
Get it in, Beth.
There you go, you're doing good.
The sixth round, baby. Coming in the sixth. Coming, okay, here. Coming in the sixth.
Once again, let's watch Fast Hands if we can see him, because James Toney doesn't apparently able to see him. There's a perfect example of an unorthodox punch coming when you leave, when you don't expect it, Gil.
And you don't see it. Those are the ones that really can get to you.
James Toney has been talking about going up to heavyweight. He said the hardest part of every fight is making weight. It's only supposition, but you suspect at this moment that making weight this time took a lot out of James Toney.
I'm not ready to take any credit away from Jones, because what Jones is doing here is just dictating everything on his own, and I'm not sure it has anything to do with the weight yet.
61% landing percentage in round five for Jones. 37 out of 61, mostly power shots. It's terrific stuff. Another left hook on the button by Roy Jones Jr.
And you notice that Jones doesn't set things up with a left jab. That's the unorthodox part of his style. He doesn't set things up. He'll move with his feet and all of a sudden leap in with that left hook, and it's very, very effective. But again, by doing that, he leaves himself open for a split second, but so far, nobody has been able to take advantage of it. Nobody that he's fought. He's so quick.
Hunter, get out. Hunter, get out. Keep him up. Don't hold him. Don't hold him. Don't hold him. Let him go. Let him go. Let him go.
Again, crackling right hand. Jones lands the last punch. Last tag. Roy Jones.
Break. Step back. Step back.
Tony's remembering now to go to the body when he gets Jones against the ropes.
You notice that Tony just didn't even try to throw it yet. He just paws out with it. But again, it's the footwork on that left hook, that fast left hook.
Ooing and dying with yet another left hook.
Same thing every time. There's no jabs involved. He doesn't have to feint the jab. He just leaps in quickly, gets an angle, and bang, right in there with that left hook.
And if you had told James Toney 2 days ago that Roy could do that, he'd have said, no
Punch
way.
Get out. Punch it out. Break. Step back. Step back.
But you're right. He's done it all the way through tonight.
Let's keep on. Don't time up. Come on. Keep on. Put your arm back. Break, step back, step back. Come on, you guys, let's work.
There was a question, again, where Toney was just too slow getting off, and instead of Jones waiting to block a punch, beat him to the punch. He's back in the corner again, and again, who gets off first? Jones.
Halfway through the battle for James Toney's IBF Super Middleweight Championship so far. A spectacular, virtuoso performance by the challenger, Roy Jones Jr.
Getting a little closer to this stuff now. Let it come here. I want you to just some of the jabs, some of the hooks you're going down. From inside with it. Instead of outside with it, stick
the time.
Right.
When
it comes to it. Right. It's time to put a little more pressure. Put a little pressure. We got him on our territory now. Coming into the championship round.
That's right.
Being through the middle. Through the middle. Okay. Try to make, he's flicking for everything you do. Every time you flick at him, man, he's going for it. All right. Okay.
Although we're only halfway through the scheduled 12 rounds, we're already at that stage where James Toney looks like he's going to have to do something dramatic to get back into the fight.
It would have to be very, very dramatic, Larry, like a knockout. Counting that knockdown, he's already 7 points behind, and he's got six rounds to catch up.
He's done it in the past, but maybe not against fighters the quality of Roy Jones Jr. He was down on points when he knocked out Nunn in the hunt to win the world middleweight championship in 91. He needed to knock out Tim Littles in a specific round because of a bad head cut to win that fight, and did it against a fighter who'd never been down or out. So it's not out of the question, but this is still all Roy Jones as round seven begins.
But again,
solid left. Toney in a little bit of trouble.
Again, Jones is really never directly in front of James Toney. He throws angle shots, and Toney really doesn't know where the punches are coming from. There was a foul by Roy Jones. We have the rope and use that for leverage.
Right, step back. Don't hold the rope.
And Steele tells him not to do it. James Toney just completely befuddled by Jones's speed, unorthodoxy, quickness.
Again, Toney, he's playing hide and seek with Toney in the ring. We're in a ring, they're both inside of it. Half the time, Toney doesn't know where he is. Yeah, waiting against the ropes.
What in the world can Toney do, Gil, to nullify the effectiveness of Jones's left hook?
The only thing he can do is start banging to the body. When you have a guy against the ropes, don't even think. Throw a straight right hand to the body and try to come back with a left hook. You're going to hit something, even if you hit his arms. But if you hesitate, wait for an opening, he gets off first and beats him to the punch. Yeah, you can see Toney hesitating.
Good counter there by James Toney, but it's hard to find a round here that you might have given to the champion. What other middleweights could throw combinations with that hand speed, Gil?
I would have to go back a long way, maybe to Sugar Ray Robinson. He can throw punches that fast and that effective.
Work your way out. Punch. Your hands are free. Pull your arms back, Roy. Pull your arms back.
And remember, this is 168 pounds, 8 pounds up from the old middleweight limit of 160.
Again, Jones comes back in the exchanges. Good left hook by James Toney.
Best punch of the fight for Toney, the left that ended round seven.
Good that you're getting a little nasty. You hear me? Especially when we're inside. We got to take this fight. We're on our territory now. We got to make our move.
Harold, seven rounds, your score.
Larry, 70-62, 7-0, Roy Jones. I never saw a super middleweight throw 6-7-8 punch combination he throws. He's absolutely beautiful.
Yes, you have to, okay?
Here you go.
He weakened his legs, man. He can't move. I know, he can't move, though. You can hit him all day, keeping at your range.
Okay,
let's go.
Let's make our move now, champ. Let's go.
Five rounds left.
So far, both fighters have caught some stiff punches, but they haven't really hurt each other that badly yet. I was surprised. Even Toney landed a few good straight punches. They just wiped right off of Jones.
I thought that Toney was hurt a couple of times during the fight, Larry. Not seriously, but hurt.
How about now? How about right now?
He's just being completely overwhelmed.
And I think a left hook to the body hurt James Toney badly to set this up. Jones landed a wallop to Tony's ribcage.
Keep him in front!
And James Toney hasn't thrown a punch since that body shot.
And look how cool Roy Jones is.
Keep him in front. Don't hold him. Roy, step back, step back, step back.
Jones has knocked men out with body shots. Glenn Wolf in the first round, for instance. And now Toney begins to throw again, but
tried to counter, but again, that those reflexes of Jones, just nothing's there when you punch at it.
Two more left hooks right on the button.
And the thing that amazes me, you know, you say Jones is a boxer, he does this without using a left jab.
Both men have dispensed with the jab completely. And this is just going to be a slugfest the rest of the way.
James Toney always has had a good left jab. Outside, he proved it in the Prince Charles Williams fight. But again,
he's not using it. He's just walking in, Gil. There he paused with it a little bit. But the snapping left jab is gone from Tony's arsenal. Just walking in.
We thought Jones would move more away from Tony, but he's really been contemptuous of Tony in the last couple of rounds.
Again, he can go on the ropes. No matter where he goes, Tony just can't hit him.
Sledgehammer right over the top by Tony. Glancing blow. Didn't get all of the target.
Again, in that exchange, last tag by Roy Jones.
Tony showing some assertiveness now, but he took a lot of this round off after he took that crushing left to the body early on. There's a left hook by James Toney. And Jones comes back with a fury. And Steele stops Toney right in the middle of his best action.
What is Steele doing? What is Richard Steele doing?
Hear the bell. And that really hurt James Toney.
Yeah. Shot him in punches.
Yeah. Come on in, baby.
I'm here, dude.
Lying him up.
Try to hit and don't get hit this time. All right. Let's go. You be first. You get off first. Don't wait for him. All right.
Round 9 begins. You saw the champion breathing hard in his corner.
Right now, this 168-pound championship belongs to Roy Jones. It's up to James Toney to win it back.
And Miller still hasn't spoken to James Toney with any real sense of urgency, saying, James, you're going to have to do something big. You know, he's talking very, very matter-of-factly. Slipped by Jones, and Toney did not take advantage.
Toney a little more cautious than he's been in other fights. And Jones' left hand has shown us the reason why, over and over. You said before the fight, Larry Merchant, that Roy Jones Jr. was a mystery. How much of the unknown is left now?
Well, beyond any question, he's answered a lot of those questions. It's in his grasp.
Get out! Break! Step back! Step back! Pull him back, Roy! Pull him back! Pull him back! Pull him back! Come on, get out! Break! Step back! Step back! Step back!
Looks as if Roy Jones is taking a round off.
He may take the rest of the fight off, Gil.
Step back, step back.
Jones. Left hook over the top by Jones. Tony trying to stalk, but not punching his way in effectively. Short left hook by Jones, the more effective of the two punches there. Tony's sweeping left missed badly.
Look at that footwork of Roy Jones, side to side. Again, last tag by Roy Jones. He lulls you to sleep and then he tries to put you to sleep.
Drinks to go.
You feel that hand up there just like you did. Run it off. Man. Right up there. Put it on his head.
Other water bottle, Ronnie.
I'm hit hard, man. Come on, give it to him. Give it to him. Right. Give him the other water bottle.
Good.
We're down to our rounds. We got to make our move. We got to close the gap. You hear me?
Uh-huh.
All right. Let's close the gap now. 10th round, sir. We got to have it. I don't need but 9 minutes fighting. I got to have it.
So far, the mongoose is too quick for the cobra.
By this time, maybe James Toney's taken off about 7 or 8 pounds, Larry, so maybe he'll be a little quicker for the rest of the fight.
To see so far what he could find that would do the necessary damage to Jones at this point.
Well, one big left hook, a right hand on the chin
could help
at this weight, and the other guy can do a lot of funny things. You can just see the quickness of Roy Jones. Constantly moving, constantly fainting.
Don't hold him!
Tony, so cool, so non-existent as he gave the first two rounds away. Then he got knocked down in the third. And since that time, Roy Jones, to our eyes at least, has seemed to simply pile up the points.
Again, Jones is just such an unorthodox fighter. A couple of times in the fight, when he's against the ropes, he actually pulls his head back, which is a fundamental no-no, but he gets away with it.
Jones again stepping in with that left hook and then gone as Tony looked around to find it.
Right now, they're cooling each other off with those missed roundhouse punches.
Punching it out of him. Punching it out. Break. Step back.
Again, Tony moves him into the corners and against the ropes, but then he allows Jones to get off first. Yeah, he's chasing, chasing, chasing. But nothing happens. Let's see who gets off first here.
Come on, work, work.
That was a dangerous left hook by James Tony.
Thunderous right inside by Jones.
Jones is looking at the clock. That could be an indication that he's starting to get a little tired.
Come on, let's work this side. Work this side. Pull him back. Pull him back.
Chopping right hand for Tony.
Jones was moving away with the punch. Wasn't a very effective punch.
Oh,
minutes if you want to fight. You got to have this 6 minutes, okay?
Uh-huh.
All right. Show it to me.
Okay, huh?
Let's go. We got to have it.
Him turning, champ. Don't give him nothing he want to have. Make him find you. Be that needle in the haystack. Be that needle. You got 2 rounds left, champ. 2 rounds left and you remain. 2 rounds left and
Harold,
you remain.
10 rounds, your score.
Larry, I thought James Toney stole the 10th round. Roy didn't do a heck of a lot. 9 rounds to 1, 99-90. Roy Jones, he is so quick. He's moving so nicely, landing so many great combination punches. You just can't take it away from him. James Toney's going to need a dynamite finish to win this fight.
Dynamite is the operative word. He's going to have to throw a stick of dynamite in there to blow this man up, but I'm not sure that would do it.
Well, the only thing, in my opinion, now that can do it is a knockout.
Agreed.
Roy Jones only threw 32 punches in round 10. That drops way down from his previous punch output. It was in the 11th round when Toney scored the dramatic comeback knockout of Michael Nunn back in 1991 that won him the middleweight championship. But Nunn was not the kind of power puncher that Roy Jones had.
You heard the advice to Jones in the corner, be a needle in a haystack. That's the way of the trainer telling him, get out of there, you got the fight won.
Gil, is it even possible that Toney deludes himself into believing that he's still got a shot at winning a decision here?
I would have to say the fighter, yes, but the trainer should know better. The trainer should be telling him you need a knockout to win this fight.
Bill Miller hasn't said that at any point, has he?
No, he hasn't. He said we need this 6 minutes. The 6 minutes won't do him any good, in my opinion, and on my scorecard. I think we're going to have an exciting 12th round. Again, Jones is killing the clock, not doing too much this round.
Thudding an inside left against Tony's head there. Toney putting in the body work on the ropes, but it's probably too little too late. Crowd begins to try to lift the champion. Well, this goes to show you that James has built a following in his 3 years as a world champion.
Boy, there are a lot of people who bet on him.
Jones nailed Toney with a solid left hook.
And Toney wobbles just slightly against the ropes again.
Look how calm Jones is in there. Sending range punches, then hard punches. He's doing it all.
To say, Larry, that for a decision to be taken away from Roy Jones, it would almost have to be the Olympics.
Now, if this was taken away from Roy Jones, it would be worse than the Olympics. He may have been a little tired before Jones, but he's got a second win. He's right back in there now.
And still, James Toney showing none of the desperation style commitment that we all think would be necessary for him to salvage the fight.
Got to have this last. Got to have it, James. We need it. We need this here. I got to have this here. We need it. There's no more tomorrow. This is it.
On your head. Okay? I want you to touch him, put them 3 or 4 point combinations on him and go.
On your head. I'm on your head.
Let me talk.
And final round.
Okay? Run, listen to me. Don't give him a chance. Don't give him a chance to take nothing, okay?
Good.
Yo, pick that piece of ice over there, Bill. That's what it's going to play. Okay.
Don't get him.
Give it to me. Give it to me.
In the corner of the undefeated champion with the best record of any undefeated world titleist in the sport. There was silence for the last 20 seconds of that 1 minute break between rounds. Nobody said to James, you must have a knockout to win the fight. Now here comes Tony with his last 3 minutes to try to get something done against aspiring super middleweight champion Roy Jones.
Tony just takes so long to get off. He allowed Jones to escape. He's fainting, fainting, fainting. What is he waiting for?
Keep him up, keep him up. Punch and get out of this.
Good solid body punch by Jones.
Smart stuff. At what point, Gil, does Jones simply try to stay away?
Well, the way they told him in the corner that don't take any chances, but throw some good solid punches. I mean, I know if I was in his corner, I'd be saying, they just killed the clock, you got the fight won. I didn't do that too often, but when the guy's this far ahead, why take any kind of chance?
Punch in the break, somebody.
I used to always tell my fighters, you have to win the last round, especially if you're near the guy's hometown.
Yeah, but you wouldn't have told Jones tonight that he had to win this last round, would you?
No, I would not have. As they say, he's, in my opinion, there's no way they could take it away from him.
It's been a spectacular display by Roy Jones. He continues to step in and fire the left hook from time to time. And Tony, simply not busy enough to be building toward the climax he needs.
He just can't get off. Can't get off. The movement has been puzzling him all night long. Big right hand by Jones.
Right on the button. 1 minute to go.
Big left hook by Jones.
Yet another one.
Right.
And these are solid punches, which means that Tony has to have a chin of granite.
Punching it out. Right.
Sand is running out of the clock for James Toney.
More than 6 years ago, Roy Jones Jr. was victimized by what most observers called the worst decision in the history of amateur boxing. It robbed him of an expected gold medal at the Olympic Games in Seoul in 1988. He's waited all this time to regain center stage. And now tonight, in the biggest fight of his career, against a man regarded by many as the most skilled champion in the sport, Roy Jones has been every bit as dominant as he was that day in Korea so long ago.
The kind of fighter that James Toney has been over the last year and a half, that's just a terrific performance by Roy Jones.
Yes, it is. And you know, we had mentioned about putting on all that weight, and I was told that he had done that in quite a few fights, but that eventually has to catch up with you, Larry. I don't think that James Toney was on top of his game tonight. I know Jones was great, but Toney was not Toney tonight.
Yeah, but I'm in Larry's corner on this one. Let's not harp on that too much, because any harping on it takes away from a spectacular performance by Roy Jones, which, in my view, and maybe yours, Gil, answered just about every remaining question about it.
I thought he was absolutely great tonight. Again, he's a very unorthodox fighter. He does things his own way. I don't think he even knows what he's going to do, but boy, it's effective.
The fight plan for Jones was for a lot of power shots and very few jabs. He followed it to a T. Let's go to the ring announcer, Michael Buffer, for the official decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, here at the MGM Grand of Las Vegas, we go to the scorecards. John Stewart scores the bout, 119 to 10. Glenn Hamada scores it, 117 to 110. And Jerry Roth has it, 118 to 109, for the winner by unanimous decision. And new super middleweight champion of the world, Roy Jones Jr.
Thank you.
Go, please, stick around. More boxing to go here at the MGM Grand.
First loss of James Toney's career. Roy Jones moves to 27-0, and based on tonight's performance, the sky's the limit. So in the end, it was the near whitewash we might have anticipated on the scorecards. Only one judge, Glenn Hamada, finding a way to give as many as three rounds to the champion, James Toney. Little punch stat numbers reflect Jones's dominance in the fight. You can see that he threw 163 more punches, landed 128 more punches, and at a much higher percentage than Toney. And an interesting wrinkle. Roy Jones's fight plan was to dispense with the jab and throw power punches to make it more difficult for Toney to counter. Toney, far behind on points, eventually dispensed with the jab himself. The net result? Of all the punches thrown in the bout, 75% of them were power punches. Jabs were almost non-existent in the late rounds. After Roy Jones's overwhelming victory over Toney, Larry Merchant spoke to both winner and loser in the ring.
What did you know personally about the difficulty he was having with weight?
Well, I come from 178 sometimes, 180 to make 160. That's a very tough thing to do and fight 12 rounds. I'm a lot bigger than guys. Most time I'm a lot faster, but it's tough when it's fat. And I wasn't fat. I'd just be thick at 178 most of the time.
But,
yeah, man. Thanks, baby. Hey, good work. Yeah. Hey. Good work, baby.
Hey.
Hey.
Yeah, right?
Hey, yeah.
He is.
Hey, yeah.
Right. I'll be back. You back? Hey. I'll be back. Yeah, I'll be back. James Toney will be back. Watch out, light heavyweight.
But yeah, and you know, it's a tough thing to do. And I commended him on how he made the weight, but I knew that he would be watched. I mean, you know, the weight would work.
Well, how did that play into your plans, knowing that he would be weakened?
Well, my hands are so fast, my feet are so quick, until all I had to do was box, move around the ring, box, not taking on stupid chances. But I do like to fight, so I sat down with him a couple of times because he's a warrior. And to beat the champion, you got to beat the champ. So I sat down just to show him that.
All right, you wanted to prove not just that you were quick and strong, but that you had something inside you a few times in the fight. Is that what you're saying?
That's right, exactly. That championship quality, that stuff that it takes to be a champion. I had to prove that I have that. Unlike other champions who are other challengers who come in, challenge the champ, run from him the whole night. I never run from nobody the whole night.
Did he hurt you, daze you at all during the fight?
Never. He's a solid puncher, but you know, my chin is real tough. I caught some good shots, but they didn't bother me at all.
Did you feel you had hurt him? Seriously?
Yeah, I hurt him a couple of times. I hurt him about three or four times in the fight. And he has a strong chin, I expect, though, so I got to give him that.
You've waited 6 years to get here, James. Does this make up for Seoul finally?
Right.
Roy, I'm sorry.
Yeah, this makes up somewhat. Well, like I said, I just thank God I was healthy, able to get this far without any defeats. Thank God my hands stayed healthy throughout the entire thing. And, you know, James Toney was a wonderful champion. I stepped up, you know, took the challenge, had to do what I had to do. He'll be back. He's a great fighter.
Was he just too quick for you?
No, I wasn't that bad. I was, like I said, I was tired. My weight, from weight loss and everything. I ain't got to hold my head down, bro.
Did having to take off so much weight before your fights finally catch up with you, is that what you're saying?
Probably did, but you know, it don't matter. He didn't do nothing to me. Now I feel good. I'll be back. I'm a great champ. I will be back.
Did he ever hurt you, for particularly when he knocked you down?
No, no knockdown. I was off balance. I was dug out of the way of his punches, and I failed.
All right, we're going to try to run that up and see if you can describe. Now, here you were doing some posturing just before the knockdown. Explain to us.
I'm dug out of the way. See? He pushed me right there. See it? It's a push. It was a push. You see that? I wouldn't hurt nothing. I came back and forth.
You never hit the canvas yourself, did you?
Never. This is my gloves.
But you must surely be disappointed after so many outstanding fights, undefeated, fighting so often, to be mastered in this way.
I wasn't mastered. You know, I just had a bad night. I'll be back. Like I said, I will be back. It's a good fight. Tip my hat off to him. The man won the fight fair and square. I ain't got no excuses. He's a better man than that, but I will be back, though. That's a lot of heavyweight.
So now we look ahead to the future. What will Roy Jones do as a champion at 168 pounds? What will James Toney do? You heard him suggest in the ring that his next fight would be as a light heavyweight with a 175-pound weight limit. Gil Clancy, obviously, Roy Jones looks ahead to some terrific marketability as a new superstar in the sport. But who's he going to fight?
Well, I only see one guy out there that could make it interesting, and that's Gerald McClellan, and only because he can punch. But it's more likely that Roy Jones Jr. will pitch another shutout.
And then?
He may have to move up in weight. I mean, I had Emil Griffith when he was welterweight champion. He ran out of guys to fight, had to move all the way up to middleweight. And I think that Jones may have to take that next step up and maybe fight a Virgil Hill for the light heavyweight championship.
Wouldn't it be a shame to see him lose the chance to continue performing at this weight level where he is so obviously a natural, spectacular talent?
Well, that's boxing. I mean, that's what happens. If there's nobody out there for him, he will have to move up, make that sacrifice.
And that's part of the business of boxing, and we'll see what happens with that in the months to come. But right now, a final word on Roy Jones's artistic presence in the ring against James Toney. From you, Larry.
Well, I think all of us came here for more than the championship fight. This kind of a showdown brings something else out of us. We wanted to collect a memory. There have been so many references in the last weeks to all those great middleweight dramas of the 80s. Hagler versus Leonard versus Hearns versus Duran. And we were looking forward to something like that tonight. I'm not sure if it was Tony's gluttonous ways that made him a glutton for punishment tonight. It seemed to me that no matter what James Toney did, he was going to get licked by Roy Jones Jr.'s Quick, and perhaps that alone will stamp this event indelibly in our minds when we look back on Roy Jones' career.
Indeed. The three of us will have more to say about boxing in just a moment, but right now, let's look ahead to some upcoming entertainment events here on HBO.
HBO original movie. Coming in December, only on HBO.
Back to the subject of boxing for a moment now as we look ahead to the next edition of World Championship Boxing here on HBO. It'll be December 3 as former heavyweight champion Riddick Bowe goes into the ring here in Las Vegas against young heavyweight contender Larry Donald. Gil Clancy, what challenge, if any, does Donald pose to Bowe?
Well, Bowe is the challenge for Bowe. He has to get back into the condition that he was when he won the heavyweight championship of the world. Against Larry Donald, not a big puncher or anything, but he's a well-conditioned guy. And his manager, Robert Middleman, called me and said, definitely Donald will win the fight. We have Bo right where we want him.
Robert Middleman managing the slick, quick former Olympian. He was a member of the United States Olympic team in Barcelona in 1992. And Larry Merchant, why would Middleman and the people around Donald believe that they have Bo right where they want him?
Well, most people think the fight is premature for Donald. He's 17-0, but he hasn't fought any stiff opposition yet. But they just think they can jump on a Bowe who is still depressed from losing his heavyweight championship back to Evander Holyfield and being out of the heavyweight picture for now. And nobody knows whether he can get it again to get on the scale and be in shape. So that's why we're all thinking once again of gluttony, gluttons for punishment. And me personally, I'm thinking of the great fight novel and movie, Fat City, revisited.
As we go back to Riddick Bowe, who got an incomplete report card for his no contest appearance against Buster Mathis Jr. in late summer in Atlantic City. He'll be looking for a victory over Donald as he tries to angle toward another heavyweight championship challenge. And we remind you of an unusual starting time for that telecast. It'll be at 9:30 p.m. Eastern Time, 6:30 Pacific Time, the 10-round heavyweight fight between Riddick Bowe and Larry Donald here on HBO. A final look back now at the events of November 18, 1994, Roy Jones becoming the new IBF super middleweight champion with his resounding unanimous decision victory over James Toney, punctuated by this semi-controversial third round knockdown, Toney's seat never really reaching the canvas, but all a part of the overwhelming performance by Jones, which made him an easy choice in fight. Turn to HBO for the show The Pros Watch Inside the NFL, as hosts Lynn Dawson, Nick Buonocatti, and Chris Collinsworth are joined by Jimmy Johnson to take a complete look back and the first look ahead at all the action throughout the NFL, premiering Thursday nights at 11 p.m. Eastern and Pacific time. So for Larry Merchant, Gil Clancy, and Harold Lederman, I'm Jim Lapley, saying so long from the MGM Grand in Las Vegas, Nevada. The executive producer of HBO Sports is Ross Greenberg. Tonight's program was produced by Rick Bernadine and directed by Mark Payton. The associate producers were Steve Cohen, David Hoffman, and Adam Berger. Assistants to the producer, Artie Curry, Dave Leibson, Thomas Odelfelt, and Max Siegel. The production manager was John McCallum, and the technical supervisor, Bob Hunter.
This has been a presentation of HBO Sports, the network of champions.